wanted to check for ourselves that they were on sale right now in supermarkets. So Professor Broom agreed to go on a hawkburn hunt, this time with a secret camera following his movements. Professor Broom went shopping in the Cambridge branch of each of the big four supermarkets. It wasn't long before he found the first chicken with a hawkburn, a telltale brown mark on the rounded, scaly part of the leg.
An obvious hawkburn there. More on one leg than the other.
And as he continued his buying spree, Professor Broom had no trouble finding them. They were in every supermarket he went to.
The damage to the tissue in with a hawkburn of this size would go down several millimetres into the tissue, so that would be quite painful, something like that.
He even found chickens where the hawkburn had been carefully removed before the bird was packed.
You can see the hawkburn area, even though the scales have been removed there. You can see that the tissue underneath the scales is damaged by the hawkburn.
After several hours of intense shopping, Professor Broom had struck unlucky in all of the big four supermarkets.
On this bird here, this is a fairly severe hawkburn, at least for a grade A chicken. Now on this bird you can see that there is a small area of hawkburn there, a medium size there, and then there's an area where the scales are missing. There might well have been a more extensive hawkburn there. And then on this bird here you can see the tail end, the parson's nose, has a lot of red coloration on it. That area there would be the result of contact with the litter and some sort of friction on the litter for this bird during the time that it's in the house. I think people don't realise that they actually can just look at the bird in the supermarket and they can see these brown marks on the legs. Anybody can do this and can decide whether or not to purchase the bird.
The Supermarkets Trade Association, the British Retail Consortium, told us...
Supermarkets take the issue of animal welfare extremely seriously, and it is a fundamental requirement of their suppliers.
They added that animal welfare is...
controlled through strict production standards, one of which is assured chicken production. Any breaches in these standards are unacceptable and are always taken up with the producer.
This chick has a disease called coccidiosis. It's a bacterial infection of the gut, which can sweep through a flock of chickens in no time. It causes loss of appetite and diarrhea. Birds with coccidiosis pass droppings containing tiny little spores called oocysts. And if, in the cramped conditions of the broiler house, birds start to peck at those droppings, the whole flock can soon be infected. But responsible chicken farmers like Alan Simpson take preventative measures by giving the birds feed containing special drugs called coccidiostats. They've been doing it for years. Trouble is, not much is known about the effect of coccidiostats on people. So, to be safe, farmers are required to withdraw them from the birds' feed several days before slaughter. But organic farming pressure group, the Soil Association, are worried that there may be some left when they're plucked, filleted, and whisked off to the shelves. We decided to put the supermarket's cheap chicken to the test. We went to all four major supermarkets and brought frozen chickens in each, and some chicken livers too, because that's where the coccidiostats are most likely to be found. We sent them to a top research lab in Germany to be tested for any sign of coccidiostat residue. This is what they found. There were traces in 37 of our 40 supermarket samples. No problem there, though, because the amounts we found are well within the government's acceptable limit of 200 micrograms per kilogram of meat. But all our chickens had the same coccidiostat in them. It's called nicarbazin, and it's the subject of a bit of a Euro scrap. Dr. Vivian Howard is one of the country's leading toxicologists.
With respect to nicarbazin, this has been looked at by the EU in their FEDAP committee. And once again, they've come up with a report which says there isn't enough information there for them to make a decision about the mutagenicity. So that's the ability of this medicine or drug to actually cause damage to DNA. And so they, in the absence of that information, they are saying that they can't set a maximum residue level.
In other words, they can't decide whether nicarbazin is definitely safe at any level. And what that means is that whilst here in the UK, the residue levels we found were well within the government's acceptable limits, some experts think there's good reason to be extra careful.
I think we can be fairly certain that if you're eating chicken from broiler houses, you will be getting a level of exposure to this compound. Now, of course, the regulators will say, but it's underneath the maximum residue level, therefore it's safe. But I think that really, particularly with respect to infants and the fetus, we should be minimizing exposure.
Now, it's not just me, is it? These bigger, grow-faster chickens do seem to produce an awful lot of fat when they're cooked in the pan. So is the modern way of eating breeding not just obese children, but obese chickens too? Well, there's only one way to find out. Liposuction. This is the Institute of Brain Chemistry and Human Nutrition at London Metropolitan University. We've brought along a chicken from each of the big four supermarkets, Tesco, Sainsbury's, Morrison's and Asda, so the boffins here can find out what they're made of. They're going to start by extracting all the fat to see if these cheap chickens are just obese couch potatoes. First step, into the blender. The necessary chemicals are standing by. The whole chicken has to be reduced to a pink goo. Then add some solvent, and the long process of extracting the fat is underway. A week later, the tests are all complete, and I'm back at the Institute to meet with Michael Crawford. No, not that one. Dr. Michael Crawford. He's the man who supervised the tests for us, and apparently he's got some startling results.
Well, this is the fat out of one single chicken, and that was about 17% fat.
That's almost a pint of fat from one chicken.
I'm horrified by this.
Basically, they were all the same.
I eat a lot of chicken.
Right.
Because I think it's low in fat.
Well, it isn't.
And that's
just out of one chicken. I mean, what effectively you're getting here, the big problem is that you're getting, in terms of the calorie value, more calories coming from fat than protein. And what this means is that the public thinks they're buying a protein-rich food. Mm. In fact, they're buying a fat-rich food. In 1976, the Royal College of Physicians, British Cardiac Society, said in their report on coronary heart disease, if you want to avoid heart disease, eat less fatty red meat and choose chicken because it's low in fat.
Mm. And that's
stuck. Used to be the case.
It was the case that
chickens provided more protein than fat. Now it's the other way around.
Chickens didn't always used to have this much.
No, of course it didn't.
Did they? So why do they now?
What happens is that if you feed the animal on a high energy diet and if it doesn't get any exercise, it does put on weight, and the weight that it puts on, a large part of that is fat.
So this extra fatty chicken that we're all buying, I think we buy 850 million of them a year now. This extra fatty one has in a way, been created
yes.
by the demand of the supermarkets.